All right, welcome back to part three. In part three, we're going to talk about how we use the data that we've collected to help define the nature of the problem. And this is probably one of the more critical steps in this process. It's important to clearly define the behavior and to select the right tool, but it's really, really important to really spend time defining what that problem is. Who's involved? What does it look like? Why is it happening? In order to really guide an intervention. And so we're going to talk about what that looks like in this section. So we're now looking at how would we know what the nature of the problem is? So you'll recall this flowchart where we're thinking about our students are still engaging in a problem behavior. Are the behaviors minor violations? How would we know whether they're major or minor? One of the things we would look at to know that is to think about the dimensions of behavior. Is the frequency of a particular behavior so high or so low that it becomes a problem? Is the duration of a behavior something that tips it over into an area where it's a problem behavior? Is the force or the locus of a behavior the thing that makes it a problem behavior? And one of the things that that classroom teachers and schools have found really useful to do is actually think about this ahead of time and define what major versus minor behaviors are. Think about where is that line for your classroom, for your small group, for your school. Ideally, you can work together as a school and come to some consensus, but even if you can't do that with your whole staff, doing this within your classroom and thinking ahead of time about what are the things that are considered minor behaviors and what are the things that are definitely major behaviors and should be office handled is a really important thing. So thinking about what types of things are you going to handle in your classroom and what are the things that you're definitely going to need some extra support for. There are a lot of examples that have been put together by schools that are available that are linked in that data guide that you can access. Many schools and teachers put together an actual flowchart where they work their way through a really predictable system of how they're going to respond to major versus minor problems. Thinking about if it's a major behavior, you're going to get some additional support from a behavior coach or an administrator. If it's a minor behavior, then you're going to think about what your response is and how might you think about a response that makes it a teaching opportunity. How can you reteach that behavior, reinforce the appropriate behavior you want to see, and discourage that inappropriate behavior you want to see in the future? And if that behavior continues to happen in the future, where is that tipping point that you then still need support? So if it's a repeated minor problem, eventually it's going to become a major problem that you probably need support for if your intervention isn't working. And so defining all of that ahead of time, use some of these examples, think through that piece. All right, we're going to pause for a minute and ask you to do a discussion board activity. And this activity, we'd like you to play a little bit with that flowchart that helps define what's major versus minor and think a little bit about the definitions that you use in your classroom or that are used in your school. So think a little bit about how you define minor versus major behavior infractions for your classroom, given the age, the ability, the developmental level of the students in your classroom. What are those definitions look like for you? How closely or not do they align with the people that may work in your classroom with you or that may work in your school with you? Have you seen your school work together to define these major versus minor behavior infractions, and what did that process look like? You might want to share that with your colleagues in the discussion board post. What would your own decision tree look like if you were going to create this all by yourself? What would it look like for you to identify a process when a minor behavior infraction occurs in your classroom? What are the steps you would follow? When would you refer that out to get additional support? And discuss this process with your colleagues and classmates. Talk about those similarities and differences in your definitions and really think about how important it is for you to be aligned with the other adults that work in your program or in your school. In some cases, it's really important to be aligned, and in other cases, it's less important depending on the context and the age level of your students. So be thinking about that and how this best fits your context. Welcome back from that activity. We hope that was a helpful discussion that you had with your colleagues and peers. Always remember to be thinking about how we define those levels of problem behavior is really, really important to help improve our consistency and responses. And some of these are really subjective things that we're talking about, and then it's really difficult to understand the difference between disrespect and defiance. Where is that line? And the more you and I, or you and the other adults in your building, can be on the same page and students experience similar responses to similar behaviors, the easier shaping their behavior is going to be, the easier it is going to be to help them recognize what the boundaries are in your classroom. So it's really important to communicate these definitions with your whole team, and developing really good operational definitions, like we talked about in the last module, helps support that communication. So we can both look at the same behavior and understand what it is and what it's not. And that process sometimes feels tedious, but it really helps improve this consistency and helps pull a little bit of the subjectivity of what we're doing out of the process. Once we know whether or not behaviors are major or minor, the next kind of decision point in our tree is thinking about how many students are involved. How would you know how many students are involved in a particular problem behavior situation? One really easy way to do that is to simply count the number of students that are involved. And then I want you to think about what percentage of the students that you're working with is that, because it's going to inform your response. If you've got a situation where the majority of your students, so let's say you're working with a small group of 5 students and 3 of them are involved in this behavior on a regular basis, that's the majority of your students. We're going to suggest to you that that's a situation in which you're going to intensify those tier one supports until you have most students responding appropriately, before you start building individualized support plans for students or even small group support plans. We want to make sure that our tier one system, even in a small group setting, is in place with enough fidelity and enough intensity to support the needs of most students. So think about how many kids are involved and think about where that puts you in a continuum of support. Are you looking at intensifying your universal support for your group or your class? Are you looking at a small group situation where you have some kids who need support? Or are you really just looking at 1 or 2 students that need intensive individualized support? We're going to think a little further about defining the nature of the problem here. We're going to think about how to really sort of tailor our language to lead us towards an intervention. One of the things that we're pretty good at doing in schools is defining problems in what we'll call a primary way, one that points out a concern but isn't particularly useful for solving that concern. So it's a pretty broad statement that just says, yep, all the kids are out of control, or nope, that's a terrible situation, I don't want to go in there, but it doesn't really point you towards how to solve the problem. Precision problem statements, on the other hand, really guide you towards a solution. So when you think about a precision problem statement, it lets you know what that problem behavior is, how often it's happening, where it's happening, who's engaged, when it's most likely to occur, why it's happening, and then what data do we need to guide our decision. So if we think about some examples of these, an example of a primary statement might be, there's too many students off task in my class. November had more office referrals than October. Tardiness is increasing. This class is out of control. The student's disrespect is disrupting instruction. All of those may be very, very true and definitely are causes of concern, but none of them point you directly towards a solution that might help guide intervention. When we look at a precision statement, we might look at something like this. There are more students off task during small group instruction this week than last. It typically includes 3 or 4 out of the 6 students in the group. Off task behavior is more likely to occur toward the end of the lesson when the teacher is working with one student and the others are asked to follow along. And that off task behavior appears to be related to getting teacher attention. So that precision problem statement has a lot of information in it that will help guide what we should do to help solve that problem. So let's take a look at this, this example. What does it tell us? It tells us that more students are off task. It tells us it's happening during small group instruction. There are 3 or 4 out of 6 students involved. It happens more often at the end of the lesson. It also gives you a little more context about what the teacher's doing that time, working one-on-one with a student. And it hypothesizes that the reason this is happening is because the student is looking to get access to the teacher attention. So it gives us a lot of information to work with. I want you to stop and think about, in your workbook, develop a precision problem statement for a recurring but minor problem behavior in your class. See if you can generate the information to answer each of these questions. What is the behavior? Where is it happening? Who's involved? When? And why do you think it continues to happen? Take a minute and do that, and we will come back together for part 4.